So we're going to start up. So hopefully our Facebook Live has begun. And so you're here at the Virtual After School Art Club. My name is Serena Sanborn. And we've been doing these virtual videos for folks to join in. And today our whole plan was plein air painting, which means, by the way, it is French for outdoors. And it is often very loose and changeable and fun. Plus there's birds, so I love going outside to draw. But today it is raining here in Maine and it is very cold. I tried actually this morning going outside and seeing if our porch might offer a little bit of shelter, but it really wasn't enough. It's just really, really damp outside. So plein air, we're doing plein air indoors. So I guess we should probably not call it plein air, but we'll just call it landscape drawings. So,
hi from Macy.
Oh, Macy's here. Oh, awesome. Hey, Macy. So nice to see you. Or know that you're there. Okay, so I thought we'd start out with, first of all, so plein air is going outside and drawing, and I really encourage you this weekend to get outside. It's supposed to be beautiful. If you can do so safely, get outside in Maine and start some drawings. And here's some supplies that I love when I'm doing stuff outside. So I love having a sketchbook. So I do have a sketchbook that I've actually started this nature journal. I'm doing a class called the Maine Master Naturalist class, and I've started this notebook. And what I love about this notebook is it has really nice thick paper, and it means that I have a surface, right? I have a surface that I can draw on. Now, if I don't use a notebook or a sketchbook, I can also just see if I have around the house, you may not have this, but a clipboard, or you can find like a nice kind of thick piece of cardboard or wood even works. And what's great about a clipboard is it has a little clip on it and I can put things on it. And I always bring a pencil box. And then my favorite tools really are watercolor, but you can also do colored pencil. So today we're gonna probably experiment a little bit with the colored pencil. If you are bringing watercolors, this particular set is a dry watercolor set, just meaning that you can add some water and it becomes nice and liquid again. And my favorite watercolor brushes, which when I discovered them, I felt like they were like a revolution, are these squeeze brush pens. So these pens are, I think, mostly Japanese. They're manufactured in Japan. And they do, they do cost like $7 or $8, but they last forever and they're super great because here's what's special about them, is they have water inside of there. And if I squeeze on this, the water comes out. Did you sort of see that? I don't know. Their water comes right out and then I can just use it. I don't need a little container for my water. I have my water in my brush. So these are, to me, they were like life-changing. I can travel with them. I can put them in a backpack. I can put them in my pocket and I have water and a brush in one piece. So
Heather Quimby is watching from Canaan.
Oh, hey, the Quimby family. I know some of the Quimbys. That's awesome. Hi. Also, if you want to set up for yourself a little, here's another thing that's kind of handy, especially if you are doing watercolor, sometimes it's handy to give yourself a little frame to work with. And this is made with electrical tape. Electrical tape is great because it is easy to get off most any paper. So this is kind of nice to have like a frame like this. So we'll talk about that and I'll show you some examples of what I've done in the past. So I always have erasers with me in my pencil box and different kinds of pencils. Like some days I feel like I really like some of these darker, soft, more charcoal pencils, but it's nice also to just have a harder lead pencil too. So, all right, so let's talk a little bit about a couple thoughts and rules about plein air painting, or setting up your canvas. So one of the things I want to talk about is the rule of thirds, which probably, if you do any kind of artwork, you've probably heard of it before, but the rule of thirds really is just that, dividing your composition into threes. So I want to show you an example. So this particular painting is by Olena Babic. Olena Babic. And is that pretty clear, Ian?
Yeah.
Yeah. So one thing you're going to see here is that this outdoor painting, she really divided this into threes. So you'll notice that this lily is not dead center in the middle of the frame. And you're actually going to notice this in a lot of photographs too. So in landscape painting and photographs, in composition that artists use, they often think about the rule of threes, though it is also a rule you can break. But it actually is pretty pleasing to the eye. So one thing you're going to notice about this is you can divide this into threes this way and to threes this way. You'll notice this big lily is sitting right on one of those planes of the, one of the divisions of the rule of three. And the waterline is even sitting on the third, right? So three this way and three this way. So you can actually notice this really is a great rule of three painting. I'm going to show you another one. So Olena is from Heartland, Maine. That's where she lives. Here's another painting by someone else in Maine, and her name is Janice Casper. Nope, Janice Anthony, sorry. There is a Janice Casper artist. So this one, which is definitely more, yes, you would say more realism. She's really a talented person doing representational realism. But you'll actually also notice, again, the rule of threes is present here. So we've got these are in thirds, these are in thirds. So again, it sort of pleases our eye, the rule of thirds. So when we're doing any kind of painting and drawing or looking at composition, it's pretty awesome to try the rule of thirds. So I also want to show you one more. So this one is actually a photograph that Ian took. So Ian takes a lot of photographs outside. And here's the example of that one. Again, I'm sorry if you can't see this as well as I can. But again, I'm actually seeing the rule of thirds in the ways that these are, again, set up. So you can sort of see that where your eyes are drawn to. Also, there's also some interesting space, negative space. We've got this is a really strong part of the composition. So this was in Gardner, is that right? So when we go outside and we pick a spot, you want to think about not putting something right in the middle, but maybe putting it off to the side, because it actually draws our eyes. Our eyes will be drawn to those spots. So I thought, because we're inside, I might just do a little bit of how to draw a tree, and we can try sketching a few trees. And then we'll maybe draw kind of a landscape. So I'm going to show you a couple things about trees. So first of all, it's really great to know a little bit of stuff about trees. But one of my favorite books to take with me is The Forest Trees of Maine. And this is if I want information about the trees I'm drawing. But what I do notice about this that's super helpful is it helps me if I'm looking at a tree and I don't know what it is and I want to know a little bit more about it, like what the leaves are like or what the fruiting parts are like. This book is really great. It also shows me sort of the general shape that the tree usually is. So when I'm outside and I'm looking at a tree, I think to myself, what is the gist of the tree? And this is something not maybe everybody knows, but the gist, the GIS, which means the general impression and size. So if I'm looking at a tree, I think, what shape is it overall? Is it an evergreen? Does it keep its needles? Or is it deciduous, meaning has it lost its leaves? So right now here in Maine, right, we have a lot of trees where it's kind of fun to draw because we can see kind of their shapes, and we don't have leaves to obscure them. Very soon we'll have leaves. Here's an example, actually, what I mean by the gist of a tree. So the American elm is a tree that we used to have a lot of in Maine until there was a Dutch elm disease, which made a lot of those trees die. So I want to show you, this is an elm. I hope you can see that. Can you kind of see it? Yeah. So the elm, what people often describe it as looking like an upside down feather duster. Watch. So there's the elm. It sort of looks like a feather duster. So that's the general impression of an elm tree. Now, different trees do different things out there. So let's look at some tree shapes, and I'll give you a couple pointers on how to draw a tree. So just because trees are the natural world, what's fun to do with drawing them, and you guys can try this at home if you have a piece of paper and a pencil. I'm using one that is pretty dark, and it's not my favorite, but because I want you to be able to see this, I'm going to use this. I've started this tree drawing, and I want to show you a little bit about how I created it. Okay, so first of all, trees are natural world things, so they don't have very sharp angles usually. And also, the lighter that you draw, and also instead of being up on the pencil where you're drawing small details, like up near the tip, you can also kind of be looser with your pencil when drawing a tree because you really want to get that natural flow in your hand and in your arm. Ideally, I'd be standing up and then maybe I'd have an easel, but really, I'm rarely gonna be able to do that. So outside, I'd probably be sitting on a rock. So here's a couple tips when drawing a tree. So right now, we are talking about, say, a maple tree or an oak tree, not a pine or a fir or something like that. So if I'm going to draw my tree, I really want it to just flow out of my pencil. And if I'm outside, I kind of look at the parts and the shapes of the tree. I actually have a picture of a tree I can show you. This tree is quite incredible. I found that online. And you guys could find a tree online if you wanted to look, or you can just look out your windows. Our windows right now have lots of raindrops all over them. But maybe I'll actually do this tree a little bit. So the first thing I want to do is look at where it's rooted to the ground, because most trees have some really cool stuff that happens at the base of the tree, right? It becomes like, it flares out at the base. And sometimes there's cool roots, and it's good to actually give it like a little place to sit. So this tree, I'm just gonna very lightly kind of sketch out where I think the branches go. Now this tree also has some really cool bark patterns and some very fun ways that it has flowing branches. So I'm gonna get a couple of those down and then show you a couple tricks that can help you. Okay, so, and you guys can do this at home or you can wait and do it another time. Okay, so this is really light right now. So if you can't see it all, I'm gonna do further stuff. Can you see it at all? A little bit? Okay. All right, so I'm gonna actually go through and make it a little bit darker for you to see. One of the cool tricks that you can do to kind of bring your eye to the places on the tree to show it, to make it more 3D, is actually go over some of the places where there are the T's in the branches. In other words, like, see if you can put more darkness and color in the places where the branches actually branch away from each other, if that makes sense. You're gonna notice that some trees branch alternately from each other and some branch opposite, meaning some trees will alternate where they are and some trees, like a maple, will have opposite branches. And you can sort of notice that when you go back outside, maybe over this weekend when it's a nice sunny day. So I'm just going to add a little bit of shading to some of the parts. And I'm also going to try filling in some texture. I should be looking more at my tree. What's so fun about an older tree is you're going to see lots and lots more texture. Like the bark is going to be more furrowed and often have more texture. A younger tree tends to have less of that happening. So just notice how just by adding this piece, a little undershading at these places where it might branch off, helps my tree look a little more 3D. So you guys can go ahead and do that. I'm going to fill in a few more of these branches. This particular tree is so great because it has all kinds of really cool shapes. More detail, right, to my tree. You guys can keep doing that. And you can kind of use, I mean, I am looking at this tree because I think there's some really cool parts to it, but you can really kind of let your pencil flow and you can just keep kind of adding more branching.
Ann Kerrigan says, it looks like a live oak.
Oh, southern, thanks. Southern. A live oak. Yeah, a southern tree. Southern trees. Yes. I think you're probably right. It does look live oak. We don't have live oak here in Maine that I know of. Thank you, Anne. I think you are correct. So it was one of the things actually that I didn't know about the South when I went to the South was how different their oaks looked. It was really, really cool to actually see that. Fun fact about oak trees is the reason we have oaks here in the Northeast is thanks to blue jays. I love that fact. We had an ice age, right? And a lot of ice left us around 12,000 years ago, and it could not have, the oak trees weren't here, and they traveled really fast up to the Northeast, and scientists started looking at why that is, and then they said, well, trees don't travel super fast, but you know who does is the blue jay. Blue jay has wings and they travel with acorns and they plant the oak trees. So thank you to blue jays for our awesome, awesome trees. Okay, so you can kind of see, I'm just keep filling it in. Now this does not look exactly like that tree, but I'm using kind of my imagination and I'm just starting to fill it in. And now I'm gonna show you how I might add leaves. So it would take me forever to add a million leaves to my tree. So what I really look at instead is the shapes of the leaves and how they gather in one's place and then the negative space. So let me show you again on this tree. So notice how you can see blue sky through some of the leaves, right? So we have blue sky parts and we can sort of see that those leaves have pretty awesome bunching in different areas. So I'm going to try to demonstrate that. I'm going to lightly draw it first. So here's just an example of starting to like add some spots and then some shading underneath because it really does look like I'm getting sunlight from above. And then I might actually put in some more general kind of sketchy lines, like some like textures and this is also a point where if you wanted to, because we're starting to get a little more detail, you can start to kind of add color, which might help a little bit. So I'm going to use my a little bit of green, and this tree definitely has some green, very, actually, in this photo, or this really green leaves. To add all kinds of color and shading. Now, when I look at this up close, like close to me, I'm like, that doesn't really look like leaves. But when I start actually looking at the whole tree, it is going to start to look like what a tree looks like when you're outside, right? You're not seeing actually individual leaves until you get close up. You're really seeing the shapes and patterns that the leaves make. So I also probably will go back into this tree and start really making a lot more patterns and textures on the trunk. And this one really has a lot of patterns and textures. So I can even just with my pencil, just kind of add almost kind of scribbles along the tree's trunk. And I'm going kind of with lines, branching lines. And I know up close again, doesn't totally look like bark, but it's gonna start to really come together as you go. You're gonna notice also outside, not every tree bark looks the same. Okay, so this is a deciduous tree, and hopefully that gives you a kind of start on how to draw something like an oak tree. But let's look at the tree that is the state of Maine tree. So happy birthday to Maine. It is it's Maine's 200th year of being a state. So let me just show you the state of Maine tree. There's actually a few different kinds in this, and these are just silhouettes. So this probably includes, it's a lot of fir, but probably some white pines in there. So the Maine state tree, if you didn't know, is the white pine. And when I look at a landscape, I love when I can see a pine or a fir or a spruce in the background, because long ago I learned how to do those from my awesome art teacher. It was Kathy Perelka, and she took us outside and we did landscape drawing. And what she said was, you can use again a very light pencil and get the shapes of these trees, and I think you communicate them really well. And even easier, I think, than the deciduous tree. So let me show you, let's see, I'm gonna choose one of these. I think actually a lot of these are more spruce, but that's okay. Yeah, that's not a white pine over there, maybe. So let me just show you how I might choose to do this. I again would keep my pencil pretty light, and I would look at what's the overall shape of this tree. And I would notice that what's interesting about a lot of these guys is they have very, very kind of set places where their branches are. And because they're needles, because they're a tree covered in needles, you can sort of see that a little bit more. You can see the sections of a coniferous tree. And sometimes they have a branch, like this one has a branch that comes out and actually swoops down. And all I'm doing is I'm just scribbling. I'm basically making a pattern that looks like this, right? I'm just really making kind of a scribble on my paper. Okay, well, so I'm just scribbling. But I am kind of getting an idea of what one of these looks like. I kind of got a little bit wider on this one. But let me show you, this morning I was outside and I just started doing some little bit of watercolor. So I will say this didn't turn out quite how I had envisioned it, which is okay. But this is outside of our house. And notice that I did watercolor of, again, these were white pines. Of some of the white pines, and all I did really was just wiggle my brush back and forth, and I think from a distance it still translates as a pine tree. I also went back over this and did a little bit of ink over the top, And I kind of like how that part turned out, but I wish that I had been a little bit lighter on my watercolor. So today's sky was mostly gray. But I feel like what I could have done maybe is make some lighter pieces here. So as you start making art, you can learn to critique yourself and also maybe also not harshly critique yourself. Just think about how you might learn from the next thing, right? Not just to say, oh, I hate this one. I'm never gonna draw this again. I'm going to actually keep practicing. Notice this is a nice watercolor paper. Every once in a while, it's nice to have even just a tiny little square of watercolor paper, because this stuff is expensive, but just a little square of it, and it actually helps absorb, it's fun to draw on, and it absorbs watercolor, and it's really fun. So I started actually just laying out my watercolor for, based on that photo that Ian had taken in Gardner. And I started also for myself looking at the composition, like where I wanted to put the clouds, where I wanted to put the dock that's in the photo. So I just started laying it out. So this is not finished, but it's just an example of how if I was outside, I might get just this far. And then I would come inside, I would have taken a picture outside, I would come inside, and then I might add more detail. Especially on a day like today that's kind of chilly. So let me show you. We're gonna try a drawing, and we're gonna lay out a drawing. So I'm gonna use this one just because I already laid out some lines for myself. You probably won't have this at home, but it's just, what's kind of fun about this is it gives you a frame. And you sometimes see like artists in movies do this, but really artists really do this. They do this outside. They make like a frame with their fingers. And they're doing that because they're like, okay, is this better? Is this better? Like, where do I want to put my composition? Like, what am I drawing? So it's always good to think about that outside. Like, where are the edges and where is the top and the bottom? So I think I'm gonna use this one, Ian. This has glass on it, so it's gonna be a little reflective for them, but can you make it so that people can see it? I don't know. Thanks, Ian.
Maybe.
Do-do-do.
It's very reflective.
Where is this one?
That is in Great Barrington, Massachusetts.
Oh, cool. So this is Great Barrington, Massachusetts. What I love about this photo is there's some fall leaves, and there's a reflection right in the water, and there is, again, the rule of thirds is there. And the colors in the water and the colors in the sky are really cool. So what I'm gonna do for myself is kind of set this up. I have to move a couple things. I'm gonna set this up so that I can see it. And then you guys could, oh, and this also changed the lighting, didn't it? Because I'm in front of a light. It's okay. So you guys at home could actually choose a photograph if you'd like to, or you can just try making up some landscape in your mind. And what I'm gonna do is, I'm gonna pretend if I was outside and I was going to draw this and say it was a nice spring main day, I would first just sketch for myself the lines of the composition. And then, so one thing I noticed about this landscape is we've got some dark trees in the foreground. We've got water, and the water line is
right about.
I definitely have more work to do. Right, I have more work to do. But let me show you some a nice thing about having this little frame here is that once I'm done my whole drawing, I can take a dark like marker or Sharpie. Probably this one is a little bit better because it's not as wide. And I can give myself a nice line around my drawing, and it kind of frames it in my notebook or sketchbook if I'm working there. And I'm going to show you what that looks like once I take off the electrical tape. So again, the electrical tape is great because it usually does not stick to the paper. I'm using it actually a tiny, kind of different paper than I'm used to, but I think this will still work. It's not working as well as it usually does. It's okay. Using a different paper. Usually in my notebook it doesn't do. Still gonna show you the nice clean lines though. So without my electrical tape, can actually see you have a nice frame. So and I am using a totally different kind of paper than I usually do, but let me show you in my notebook. Do I have an example of that? I'm going to show you a couple examples of some stuff I did outside. So again, this is my notebook that I've been doing for my class, which is all about learning about natural world stuff, which is one of my favorite things. So let me show you. So I chose a spot at Vaughn Woods in Hollowell, and I did this piece outside. So I actually don't have the frame example in this one, but you can see what I did outside mostly was just the shapes of the trees and the water. And then when I got home, I had taken a picture and I went through and I made more detail and I added more, a little bit of ink. So you can sort of, yeah, you can see that if I hold it up, I think. So I used an ink pen to go back through and get myself more detail. So one thing about watercolor that's fun is that it's so free, but then sometimes the detail is lost. So sometimes I go back in and I make a little more detail. Like one thing I think that might have worked on this is the trees. So especially maybe this tree where I did the free watercolor outside and then I came back and used my ink pen to do a little shadow to make it a little bit more realistic. I'm gonna show you maybe another one. Oh, let's see. Those are birds. We're gonna do some bird stuff next time. I can show you this. These are different kinds of barks. I started to study what do different kinds of barks look like. And what was really fun to do was to look at very closely to look at how bark colors work and to look at patterns in bark and notice how very different all these kinds of bark were. So this helped me, just a little study of that bark helps me when I'm making a bigger picture, I can kind of know how it works. Okay, I don't know if I have another great landscape example. I don't, that's okay. I did have a lens. Well, this is that's really a map. I started making a map of the site. This is actually kind of fun to do. I started making a map from overhead of the site that I've been studying. And this also just helped me, and I think this is going to help me more because I'm going to keep actually painting this particular site and looking at it because it's going to change, especially now that it's really, we've got lots of spring weather coming to us. So let's talk about what's happening next week. I'm going to move this out of the way so we get a little more light. So, what we have coming up in the next week is another Tuesday and Thursday video, a couple videos, and here's what we're going to be up to. If I can find my other, there it is. Okay. So next week on Tuesday, we're going to do bird drawings. And then on Thursday, we're going to do nature mandalas. So For this one, you want to have a collection of things. So you have to do a little prep work. For the birds, we're going to look at photographs. We're going to play some bird songs. I'm going to show you some really basic how-tos on drawing birds. This one is a great one maybe for someone who loves to go birding too and would like to do some sketches of birds. And this one is really what we're going to do is we're going to take natural materials and we're going to make a kind of cool sculpture pattern. It's going to be flat and then we can take photographs of it. So it'll be more like sculpture, which is something we haven't done yet on some of our videos. Anyways. So I will see you guys next week, hopefully, and please share what you've made, and see you next week. Thanks.